Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's Heidelberg Joint Astronomy Colloquium. It is a great honor and privilege to welcome Frank Postberg, who is a, dare I say, a pioneering expert here on the subsurface oceans of Enceladus, involved in so many space missions that my RAM froze when I tried to memorize all of them, but I'm sure you're going to mention a lot of them. Frank is from Heidelberg in terms of his PhD. He graduated here in 2007, then continued here on his first postdoc at MPIK, moved on to a postdoc in Stuttgart, after which he got a Heisenberg Fellowship from the DFG, which brought him back here to Heidelberg, and which he then took for a year to Colorado. Since 2017, Frank is holding an ERC Consolidator Grant, which he then in 2018 took to the Freie Universität Berlin, where he since holds a full professorship. And today, Frank is going to talk to us about the subsurface ocean of Enceladus, a habitable place in our solar system. So let's give him a very warm welcome.
Yeah, thank you, Diederik and Ralph, for inviting me here. So yeah, I really like that astronomers care about planetary science topics again. So this is clearly the planetary science topic. The object of interest of this talk is the subsurface, is the moon Enceladus, which was investigated by the Cassini spacecraft. And when I made my defense in physics here in this very building 12 years ago, I was already working with the Cassini data. And also that moon, that the activity of which was discovered in 2005, was already starting to become a part of my research then. So to illustrate the change of paradigm that generally came with these ocean moons, it's worth to think that a little more than 20 years ago, it was absolutely fine to say that there's only one body with liquid water in the solar system, and that is Earth. That was, I mean, it could be disputed, but it was absolutely okay to say that. And now we have between 6 and 10. Matter on how strict you do your definition, but if you say at least two independent methods have to constrain that there's liquid water, then it's 6. If you say that one strong argument enough, we are even at 10 now. And this is not on Mars, it's on these icy moons in the outer solar system. They seem to have liquid water as a more or less common feature. And the first one was Jupiter's icy moon Europa, when the first Jupiter orbiter spacecraft Galileo came to Jupiter in 1995. Also the Galilean moons were of interest, and by the means of, by measurements of the magnetic field, the disturbance of Jupiter's magnetic field by Europa was such that it has to have a conductive, something very conductive in the shallow subsurface. And that, of course, pointed at liquid water. Then later, the measurements of the higher moment of the gravity field and also topography on the surface all agreed it only makes sense if there's a global subsurface ocean. And the volume of the ocean, of Europa's ocean alone, is like a factor of 2 to 3 to all the water we have on Earth. So since then, shortly after the subsurface oceans here on Callisto and Ganymede were confirmed by the Galileo spacecraft, and then when the Cassini spacecraft arrived at Saturn in 2005, it took some complementary measurements that could convince everyone about these subsurface oceans, but now everyone believes that Enceladus and also Saturn and also Titan have a subsurface ocean. So Enceladus and Europa are special in a way that only there the ocean rests on top of a silicate core, whereas on the other three larger moons there's a high-pressure ice layer sandwiching the ocean between the upper icy crust. And that is, of course, bad for the astrobiological potential. So astrobiologists liked to have rock-water interaction, chemistry going on there. That makes it easier to start a prebiotic chemistry, at least in theory. The sizes here are about the same right proportion. So you see that Enceladus is by far the smallest one. And that is also important if we want to understand how Enceladus maintains a liquid ocean. Tidal heating is a very important heating mechanism. Ganymede and Titan, they are large enough, or certainly, let's say, Titan and Callisto, for example, there the heat is mostly stored primordial heat, but on Europa and Enceladus and also some Ganymede, tidal heating is a very important generator that only with that you can maintain the liquid water over geological time scales, especially at Saturn, they would freeze relatively quickly if you don't have an internal heating mechanism. So these are the moons of Saturn, and in contrast to Jupiter, Saturn only has one big moon, Titan. It's the same size category as the Galilean moons, but it has a range of mid-sized icy moons that you don't find in the Jupiter system. And here is the correct distances. Most of these icy moons here, and Mimas, Enceladus, Tethys, Dione, and Rhea, they are all embedded in Saturn's outermost ring. That's the diffuse, dusty E-ring, which is, in contrast to the main rings, is composed of very tenuous and very fine-grained material. So micrometer scale, whereas the main rings consist of millimeter to meter scale constituents. And Enceladus here sits right at the brightest part of the E-ring. So even before the Cassini spacecraft arrived, people were thinking, well, yeah, Enceladus and the E-ring, they might be connected. Here you see Enceladus sitting at the brightest part. This is now a real Cassini image, or it's a mosaic of about 140 images. And the E-ring is very difficult to observe from Earth because the particles are so small it hardly reflects light. So they were discovered by telescopes only in the late 1960s. So it only shines in scattered light at high phase angles. And you can only do such an observation with a spacecraft. You cannot fly behind Saturn, or you can only fly behind Saturn with a spacecraft and have an eclipse observation, like in this image. And then the main ring system is visible together with the dusty rings here, the G-ring and the E-ring. And here Enceladus, and here's Tethys. And so the question only was, why is Enceladus' orbit connected with the brightest part of the E-ring? There were many models on the market. Already in the 80s, people speculated about activity might be a reason, without any idea how this activity might be fueled. But then in the early 90s, there was a model that didn't need activity, that was just based on impact ejecta mechanism, and then it was solved until Cassini made these images here. Actually, the activity was not discovered by the cameras at first. It was the magnetometer and then other subsystems of Cassini that pointed at activity here, and then later only the cameras saw here these cryovolcanism, the plume of ice and water vapor shooting out from fractures in the ice crust with very high velocities into space. And here the black dot, that's Enceladus, here's the plume, and the ejection speeds here are on the orders of are so fast that the fastest particles don't fall back. They're not the small gravity of the moon cannot hold these particles, and then they form the E-ring, the escaping particles form the E-ring, and that's why the brightest part of the E-ring marks the orbit of the moon. The activity region is here these four parallel fractures. Only there, these icy fountains penetrate the crust, and it's centered around the South Pole. The South Pole is here, so directly in the middle of it. And it's also the emission of matter is correlated with an emission of heat. So this is an infrared camera image overplotted of the visual one, and then here the indicated are the most active jets that are embedded in this more or less continuous emission all along the tiger stripes, and it's a pretty stark temperature contrast here. So I'll come back to that later. Let's first have a look again on a nice Cassini image where you can see these are the four tiger stripes, and you have a curtain-like emission all along these tiger stripes with some very brighter jet-like features, which were more matter than elsewhere, is hurled out into space, and that coincides also with hot spots. Yeah. And again, you see the observation geometry here. The plume is always there. So all the time when Cassini looked and the observation conditions were right, it's there. So, but you can only observe it in scattered light. So here it's in reflective light, it's just not visible. Only here again, when you have a near eclipse, high phase angle observation, then the fine particles are there in the optical images. So it needed very specific observation geometries, and that's why the Voyager spacecraft overlooked it when they visited the Saturnian system in the early 80s. Some basic parameters. So the diameter is really tiny, 502 kilometers. And the density is remarkably high. Of course, for a terrestrial body, the density is low, but compared to other icy moons, the density is relatively high. So the other icy moons of Saturn have lower densities, some of them approaching just 1 gram per cubic centimeter, so almost entirely composed of water ice with just a small silicate core. In contrast, here Enceladus must have a large silicate component in the core. The temperatures, the equatorial temperatures, where just solar heating is responsible, you will reach 75 Kelvin. So on the poles, you would expect something between 65 and 70 Kelvin. And that's what you measure in between the tiger stripes. But here, the highest temperatures at these hotspots reach 200 Kelvin. So I have a temperature contrast of 130 Kelvin here, within a few hundred meters. And this is unique in the outer solar system. So this is why you can really talk about volcanoes, cryovolcanoes. The power that is emitted here just in this from these tiger stripes region is more than 5 gigawatt. The gas emission rate, the plume is pretty tenuous. On these images, it always looks like a massive geyser, like a fountain. But it's really tenuous, and if that becomes clear, if you look at the rate here, it's only 200 kilograms per second, and most of it you don't see. What you see here is the ice grains, and the gas to ice ratio is 10, so it's just 20 to 30 kilograms per second of ice grain distributed here over an area of several 10,000 square kilometers. So it's really, really tenuous. The ejection speed here of the gas is sometimes over a kilometer per second, supersonic speeds. The ice particle, as I said, the smallest one are in the nanometer range. The biggest one you find here are on the order of 10 micrometer only. The ice grains are ejected with somewhat slower speed. So although the gas is, of course, the driver of the, what is, the gas is accelerating the ice particles in the subsurface cracks system. They need to decouple somewhat, probably by wall collisions of the ice grains in these glacier-like crustal cracks. And if you compare that with the escape speed, then you see that the fastest ones, the fastest ice grains, they escape and form the E-ring. 90% though is slower, ejected slower than the escape speed and falls back as superfine powder snow. And actually you can see on some places on Enceladus that, that snow is piling up. And that gives a good constraint on the age of this emission. And it's very likely that it's going on geological timescales probably for at least several million years. There's no upper limit. But of course, the between 2005 and 2017, Cassini could directly observe the plume. It's not observable from Earth, at least not to my knowledge. There are some ALMA observations. I know about proposals for ALMA to observe it. Maybe have a few pixels there, but in optical, I'm not aware. And you wouldn't see it because you never have these high phase angles you need. And it's not like eruptions go on for some days and then cease. So no, the plume is always active, and individual jets have a typical lifetime of 1 to 2 years. 1 month, 2 years. So in this 12 years, some jets cease to be and others emerged. And there's a variety also in the activity, about a factor of 4, depending on the orbital position. So at the apocenter, the activity is a little bit lower, and the pericenter, it's a little bit higher. The explanation is that the crustal cracks are compressed, the apocenter, so the activity is quenched, and they are widened at the apocenter and quenched at the pericenter. Okay, and Cassini, that's here the Cassini spacecraft in an artist impression. There was no other camera around than the one on board this spacecraft. So, but you nearly need to highlight that to some people, that it's not a real photograph. But it's reconstructed from the Cassini images. And Cassini took advantage to probe this material that is coming from the subsurface. It was a unique opportunity to investigate the subsurface properties of an icy moon. And the Cassini tour was directed through the plume and through the E-ring several times to make in situ measurements of this material. And you can only do that, of course, the particles are so small. If the particles, so the traversal speeds here are in the order of 10 kilometers per second. And if the ice grains would be even just 100 micrometer or millimeter even, they would destroy the spacecraft just very quickly. But 10 nanometer is just fine. And the two instruments that took the biggest advantage of this on board were the two mass spectrometers, in situ instruments. So here the ionic neutral gas spectrometer could analyze the composition of the gas that was emitted, and the cosmic dust analyzer. That was the instrument that was constructed here at the Max Planck Institute in Heidelberg for nuclear physics, interestingly, where I did my PhD. That was the only German PI instrument, by the way, on Cassini. That was the cosmic dust analyzer, and as the name implies, it was not just a dust detector like its predecessors. It had a simple time-of-flight mass spectrometry capabilities with which you could characterize the composition of the ice grains. And that, of course, was a very nice, Enceladus was a perfect application for that. Give a short introduction how the instrument works, because it's a bit unusual. So a dust particle of whatever composition here hits a metal plate at the bottom of the instrument. So the diameter here about 45 centimeters, and this plate is about 20 centimeters in diameter. So impact speeds are in the orders of 10 kilometers per second. Micrometer dust grain not only evaporates, but a large part is turned into ions. So the kinetic energy, the impact is so violent that you have impact ionization of a substantial fraction of the dust grain. And so now, and the cations that are formed in this impact cloud, they are then accelerated by a strong electric field There's a grid system here 3 millimeters away, dragging out the positively charged ions and accelerates them towards this multiplier. And you have almost exclusively singly charged ions here. Then the time of flight just depends on the mass of the cation species. And with that, you get a time of flight mass spectrum where you have access to the molecular and elemental species, that at least the ions that are formed here. And then you have to reverse engineer and conclude on the composition. Actually, I have a movie here, so it's much better. So dust grain hits, you have an impact signal here. The impact signal gives you an idea of the size and the speed of the dust grain. And the ions are accelerated according to their atomic weight. And then you get the time of flight mass spectrum where you separate the different species. Okay, that's a typical spectrum of an ice grain, a mass spectrum. Here's the atomic mass units. And the classical cation of water ice is an hydronium ion, H3O+. But you have a spacing of mass 18 here between these peaks. So there's, you can add a neutral water molecule to ever larger water clusters here. And the only other thing you see is the sodium ion, and the sodium also forms water clusters. So having water ice grains coming from a water ice moon is nothing special, and we didn't learn much from this type of spectrum, but there were two other types. That was the most boring type. Two other types from which we really learned a lot about the subsurface of Enceladus. First, most important is this type. Even if you have no idea about chemistry or mass spectrometry, you see he is dominated by water ice, and here the sodium peak that was tiny here is now the dominating peak. Here's the hydronium peak, it's very small, this is logarithmic scale, and all kinds of sodium, chloride, hydroxide, carbonate dominate the spectrum. We could quantify the composition here with the analog experiments we developed, which simulates the impact ionization. So normally, ideally, you have a dust accelerator. We had a dust accelerator at the Max Planck Institute, but you could not accelerate icy dust. It worked only with metal dust at that time. So we have an analog experiment where we mimic the impact ionization by shooting on fine micron-sized water droplets with a laser. And with that, we could reverse engineer the spectrum with, and then we could say, well, it's just 1 to 2% of salts are enough to dominate this cation spectrum because they just like to form cations so easier and suppress the more abundant water ice. And we concluded on these components, and that was a big we learned a lot about this because these were exactly the ions that were predicted to be dissolved in an Enceladus ocean. And at that time, it was a matter of intense debate if there really is a subsurface ocean. And it was predicted if the plume is connected to a subsurface ocean, then you have to find the sodium salts. And the sodium salts should be in the ocean like they are in the Earth ocean, because that's just the compounds that water dissolves from rock. And there was, and Enceladus, it was known and accepted that there's a big rocky core. So if you have an ocean in contact with that rock, then you would dissolve the salts out of this rock, and they should be salty ocean. And the modeled ocean, the model predicted Enceladus ocean had indeed just 1% of salinity and an alkaline pH. And from this hydroxide peak, we could indeed also conclude that these ice grains, these salty ice grains, that they come from an alkaline environment. And that was like a very first measurement of an extraterrestrial liquid water or subsurface ocean. And then it was clear that we really, by analyzing this material, we not only probe an interior of a moon, but a liquid water ocean. This hypothesis was then later confirmed by other measurements, also most importantly, prominently the gravitational field, the higher moments of the gravitational field, which is very difficult on such a small moon, which has such a small gravity. It was a very delicate measurements, at the limit of the instrument, but it concluded that there are at least three different density layers which nicely fitted to ice, liquid water, and rocky core. The dimensions that were given here are 30 to 40 kilometer thick icy crust and then 10 to 20 kilometer ocean layer. A very important measurements, which turned out to be extremely important, even more important than the liquid layer, was the measurement of the size of the rocky core. And with that, because you knew the mass, you could conclude on the density, and it was so low that that the only solution was that the core is not compacted. It cannot be a 2.4 gram per cubic centimeter. There's hardly any rock, compact rock, that is has such low density. And so only porosity, about 20% porosity, then it made sense. And this is only possible on such a small moon, where you have such a small gravity. On these larger moons, like Europa and Callisto and Ganymede, their gravity would immediately compress any porosity, would self-compact the core here. But on tiny Enceladus, gravity is like about 1.1% of Earth gravity. That's just fine. You could maintain porosities there. And this becomes very, very important later when we explain the heating mechanism of Enceladus. Then the final proof that the ocean is global came only early 2016. So here at that time, 2014, people were still assuming a hemispherical ocean, you see on this press release image. People could not imagine, I mean, it was hard to accept that there's liquid water on that impossible body without having an explanation how the energy is created to maintain that. But if there's liquid water, then please let it just confine to the southern hemisphere. Then it's easier. We don't need that much energy to maintain it liquid. But then it turned out the ocean is global. And that was a very nice measurement of the libration of the moon. So like Earth moon, Enceladus is tidally locked, so it always faces with the same side towards Saturn, but it has a libration motion because of it's also in an eccentric orbit. So and this libration could be measured by looking at certain craters on the surface relatively precisely, and it was way too large. So the moon's wobble was too large, was too strong, that the whole mass of the moon would follow this. So the conclusion was that the ice shell must be decoupled from the bulk mass of the moon. And with that, you needed a global lubricant, which only can be the subsurface ocean. And since then, really everyone finally believed that there's a liquid ocean. And with, of course, you can measure the mass of the ice shell with this kind of measurement. And that you have a very precise measurement, actually better than higher moments of the gravitational field. And the ice crust was only 20 kilometers thick, not 30 to 40 kilometers. And later modeling turned out, yes, 20 kilometers is just the average value, but the ice shell thickness is varying. That was first inferred from features on the topography, precise measurement of the shape of the figure of the planet, of the moon. So the ice shell thickness is thinnest at the South Pole, less than 5 kilometers, 35 kilometers at the equator, and again at the North Pole it's becoming thinner again, 10 kilometers. And this corresponds to different ocean depths of 60 kilometers at the South Pole and 30 kilometers at the equator. This was also confirmed later by microwave emission that was observed through the ice shell. And if you model that, the microwave emission comes from a warm ocean, from an ocean at 0 degree temperature, then it only worked to observe this kind of microwave when the ice shell was less than 5 kilometers thick. Otherwise, you wouldn't observe it in this intensity and at that wavelength. So, but that enhanced the energy crisis for Enceladus, because now with a global ocean, you need not 5 gigawatt, you need 30 gigawatt. Then you have an equilibrium of cooling from, well, being far away from the sun. To compensate for that, you need 30 gigawatt internal heat. And the modelers were desperate. They were trying since 2005 to get that heat. And I come back to that in a few slides. First, I want to focus on the process, how the plume works, how the emission is created, how the ice grains are created. So the water table is inside these crustal cracks. Here, these crustal cracks, they obviously, these tiger stripes, they extend down to the oceans through these 2 to 5 kilometers of crust. And just from buoyancy arguments, isostasy, the ice shell is basically floating on the ocean, then the water column should rise through 90% of the crust, just like an iceberg is sinking 90% into an ocean. And that means that with a 5 kilometer thick crust here, the water surface is just 500 meters below space. And there's no atmosphere on this moon. The only atmosphere that comes from the gas that is emitted here. Sublimation basically doesn't play a role, so we have no other sources for atmospheres. And the water temperature here, of course, is 0 degrees, or -1 degree, because you have some salts dissolved in it, because it's obviously in equilibrium with the ice shell, so it cannot be warmer. But still, it's the pressures are so low, even here, you have some back pressure maybe in the vent here, but still, it's very close to the triple point. And that means that even at 0 degrees, the water evaporates very efficiently. The water is evaporating like water on Earth with 95 degrees. It's even, it's just because it's close to the triple point of water. And that is basically driving the plume. The evaporation of water, although close to its freezing point, is sucked out into the vacuum of space. So the vapor is here accelerated to 1 kilometer per second. So maybe just takes a 2 seconds or so to cross. This is like in a rifle. And it carries the bullets. The bullets are the ice grains, which are then hurled out into space. But the actual motor here of the plume, that's our current understanding, is just the evaporation of liquid water close to the triple point in this back-pressured crustal cracks. And now we have this observation of the very salt-rich and salt-poor particles. I showed the two example spectrums, and there's no hardly any transition between them. You either have this almost pure water ice grains, with salinity in sub-ppm values, and this very salty grains with 5 or 6 orders of magnitude higher salinity. And we can explain that if we imagine gas bubbles coming here from the surf, from the depths of the ocean, if you want. And the measurements of the gas phase indeed measure 3% volatile gases. So 97% is water vapor, but you have 3% volatile gases in the plume, and if you put these volatile gases here into the subsurface, you have inevitably gas bubbles reaching the surface. They burst, and they will create a spray of water. And that's, of course, these droplets maintain the salinity of the have the salinity of the ocean, and then they are dragged upwards and maybe become a coating here in the vent from supersaturated gas. That's of course salt poor condensing here and forming a crust. And the salt poor grains, well, they are just condensates of the vapor. So inevitably here when the gas escapes, adiabatically expands into space, then you have very efficient nucleation from the gas phase. And, of course, if you have other nozzles here somewhere in the crustal cracks, you have also have local supersaturation and condensation from the gas phase. And this naturally would explain the salt-rich grains. They are the spray from the subsurface ocean, and the salt-poor grains, they are basically represent the composition of the vapor. Then, later, measurements indicated that there's other places where we have temperatures far in excess of 0 degrees. So, and this was another constituent we found in these ice grains, SiO2, silica. And not just silica, it was a very specific form. It was extremely tiny inclusions in these ice grains. We found many thousands of them and detected it as fine-grained dust with a cosmic dust analyzer, and they were all below 10 nanometer. So, and we, for a long time, we couldn't make sense of it. Why on this water environment, why do we have silica, not some silicate, standard silicates, they have some metal ions, but we didn't see the metal ions, and it's so tiny. And it took a long time until we realized, well, that's actually a sign of hydrothermal activity. So it's only geochemically plausible if you have not cold water, but hot water in contact with the rocky core. And the reason, and it's known from Earth, a well-established indicator of hydrothermal activity is this silica. Here, for example, in the Blue Lagoon on Iceland. So the reason why silica is such a unique indicator for hot water is because its solubility is so drastically depending on temperature. I mean, of course, solubility of everything in water goes up with temperature, but for silica it's extreme. It's more than two orders of magnitude, the solubility increases from 0 degrees to 100 degrees. And of course, if you have pressure conditions where you have water temperatures, liquid water at 150 degrees, it's 3-4 orders of magnitude. And it's same thing happening here at the Blue Lagoon in Iceland. So the hot hydrothermal fluid dissolves the silica from the rock. Many, doesn't have to be SiO2 rock, it can be all kinds of rock or many kinds of rock where hot water can leach out the SiO2. And then when the water cools here on the cold Iceland air, it precipitates and makes the water murky. So the water is murky from the SiO2 nucleating in the cold water, and the people rub the silica into their faces. Yeah, it may seem stupid, but seems it is supposed to be an anti-aging agent. Really, that's why they do it. And you can actually buy it on the webpage of Blue Lagoon. You can have it delivered just for you, so a little advertisement. I should charge them for that. Yes, but of course this silica is not nano. So this is really macroscopic sand grain like silica. They would not float for long. They will eventually, in an undisturbed water, they will sink to the ground. And what we found from Enceladus is silica in a nano phase. And this is also a well-known phenomenon of dissolved silica, that it can form indeed a colloidal phase under supersaturation, under specific conditions. And this is dissolved, and then you have this growth with several reaction constants until it is, so you have a macroscopic grain, here's your nucleation core, maybe just a few molecules, then you have the nano phase, and then there's another step to the precipitated phase, PPT, and this is inhibited if you have alkaline water with moderate salinity. Then you have a stable nano-colloidal phase that's shown here from Earth water systems here. So the grain sizes here typically are some 7 nanometers, 3 nanometers is the most common size, and that really nicely matched our observation. So what we think is that we have hot hydrothermal systems somewhere at the bottom of the ocean at Enceladus dissolving the silica, and because the ocean is alkaline in contrast to the Earth's ocean, when the water cools, then it doesn't form macroscopic silica that would float, sink to the ground, but you have the nanosilica in the ocean that will just behave like Brownian particles and can easily reach the surface and can then be incorporated into the ice grains. That's a long chain of conclusions, but that was our only conclusion. And was, of course, a strong claim, and it was not generally accepted until the hydrogen was found in the gas of the plume, in the gas phase of the plume. That's now the final word. They changed their compositional measurements like every 2 years, but this is now the final everyone agreed to composition. As I said, about 97% water and about 3% other gases, carbon dioxide, about 0.5% then methane, 0.2%, ammonia, almost 1%, and then also hydrogen and other C2, C3 volatile organic gases. And specifically, the H2 was only plausible if you had hydrothermal activity at the bottom. I mean, such a small moon can never hold the hydrogen, primordial hydrogen. Even the Earth cannot do it. It will escape into space. So you have to produce it all the time. You have to replenish, and you have to replenish a lot of H2. And this only works with hydrothermal interactions. You can think about surbutanization reactions, typical oxidation of certain rocks of olivine by water. So you oxidize the iron in the mineral and set free some hydrogen. Or you can just heat up some organics, primordial organics, then you can also produce the hydrogen. But these are the only ideas people had so far, and both point at elevated temperatures. And since then, most people believe that indeed, at the core, we have hydrothermal systems. So not only a liquid ocean that needs 30 gigawatt, but we need to get at least 200 degrees Celsius at certain points. So another heating problem. So now I come back to the problem where the heat comes from. Typically, of course, on Earth, internal heat or larger planetary bodies, you have radioactive decay of long-lived metal radioisotopes like uranium or thorium. But even if Enceladus has a relatively large silicate core for an icy moon, still in absolute numbers, it's far off. So even the most optimistic model said, well, maybe half a gigawatt is possible from radioactive decay. Then, of course, the chemical processes, the serpentinization reaction I just mentioned to produce the hydrogen, is an exothermic reaction. But you can only do it, you can only do it once. Then it's over. So then people calculated, okay, let's serpentinize the entire rock and produce 30 gigawatt. How long would that go? And then you end up with like 30 million years. And it's probably, in certain locations, serpentinization might be responsible for hydrothermal systems. But it's not for the global heat budget. Only tidal heating actually can do the trick. And it was already known from the Galilean moons. The most prominent example is Io, but also Europa. But Io is very close to big Jupiter on a very highly eccentric orbit, and this is exposed to the highest tidal forces in the solar system. And that actually melts the silicate interior of the moon. And for Europa, the reason why the ocean, it can at least melt the water ice and make the ocean liquid. But here, Enceladus' eccentricity was far less compared to Io and Europa, and it was further away, at least relatively, the gravity was not as strong in absolute terms. And people tried to run the models to create heat, to dissipate the tidal energy, and with that turn it into heat. So in the ice crust, even if you show shear heating was an early idea, if you just tidal forces, you rub big walls of ice together or just flex the ice and with that warm it, people never get more than a gigawatt out of it. Same in the liquid ocean. It's not very efficient to turn tidal forces into heat. And then also in the core it didn't work, at least not in a solid core. The solid core was too stubborn to be deformed and with that create heat. But then with the unconsolidated core, for the first time people tried, well, let's not do the standard thing in planetary science and assume that the core is solid. It was the first time that we had, the idea was born that the interior of a planetary body is porous and not consolidated. And that's why people didn't think of it before the gravity field measurement. And then with an unconsolidated core, a full 3D model was run So just the core with the ocean layer on top, and then it was exposed to the tidal forces in an orbital phase, or around several million years. The model was run for 100 million years or so, and it was published less than 2 years ago. It was just Christmas 2017, and that did the trick. So it's very easily to understand if you have a porous core. A porous doesn't mean it's big caves in it. It's more like a rubble pile, like sand. Sand on the beach typically has a porosity of 20%. And of course, if you expose that to the netting of the tidal forces, you rub the constituents against each other. And this friction will create heat. This friction does the trick. And this doesn't work in a solid rock. It only works if you have this fine-grained constituents. Then you can turn a lot of the tidal input into heat. And what came out of this model was indeed 25 to 40 gigawatts. So it was really bang on, matched what was needed. Bit suspicious, but yeah, that's how it is. And it explained, it became so quickly accepted because it explained also some other observations. So it was, so the, of course the water sinks into this core, right? It wants to go to the center of gravity, and it does it here at the low latitudes near the equator. So just the ocean water sinks into the core, and then of course, it's exposed to this heated rock and heats up like in a Durchlauferhitzer. I don't have an English word for that, but I always have to think about it. And it reaches maximum temperature at the core, and then the flow is diverted in a way that the hydrothermal, the hot fluids, go in the direction of the poles, and you have the most stable. This is a snapshot of the model, showing a hydrothermal plume going up here, but these are not stable. The only stable ones are those that enter the ocean below the South Pole and below the North Pole. And of course, with that, you have the hydrothermal rock-water interactions, and you have an explanation why the ice shell is thinner at the poles. And that's why this model is not totally undisputed, but it solved so many problems, and that is always a good sign. And it also gives a temperature idea. Of course, the temperatures are model dependent, dependent on the permeability of the core. If you have high permeability, you have large flows but less heating. If you have small flows, then the heating is intense. So, but the sweet spot is about 200 degrees Celsius at the core. Then it cools a little when it goes outward and enters the ocean with around 100 degrees Celsius. And these are the corresponding pressures here. The pressures are just simple gravity. And you can see it's amazing, like at 60 kilometers depth, here at the bottom of the ocean, you have 80 bars. 0 bars are here, that's the range you have in the ocean. In the core, you go down to the center, you have 350 bars only, that's it. You don't even reach supercritical conditions of water, even in the center of the moon. And this, of course, gave another boost to the astrobiology community. Already, liquid water ocean, icy moons became pretty fashionable after the discoveries at Jupiter. But now, here with Enceladus, this reached a new era, especially because the results on Mars were not so encouraging. So astrobiologists had to find another toy, and the icy moons are now becoming important. Of course, with hydrothermal activity, this is, of course, it's plausible, right? It's not totally off. And we were, of course, now also focusing on the organic chemistry we find in the plume. I have already shown that the gas phase, there is methane and some C2 and 3-3 organics. But, I mean, that's all you can expect at 80 Kelvin, right? That are the only organic gases that are volatile at 80 Kelvin are methane and maybe C2 and some C3 organics. So, more complex organic chemistry you expect in the ice grains. And we already, since 2008, we found clear evidence of organics in the ice grains, but it was very diverse. That was the third type of ice grains, the organic-bearing ones. The concentrations varied a lot. It was very hard to reproduce the spectra. And that's why we tackled this only when we had our analog experiment perfectly tuned. And we're now publishing the paper about organics. That was actually the topic of the ERC grant. We published this very, well, this is another spectrum I show. It shows it's dominated by organic species. This is a hydrocarbon backbone, C2, C3, C4, C5, and it goes up here. The spacing is always about 13 atomic masses. So this is complex organic molecules, and we only see it in a fraction of about 1% of the ice grains. So you also have to explain that. Why is the concentration of organics varying so drastically? And why do you sometimes see just the simple organics? And in some extreme cases, you see these concentrations. They're like probably 10% organics in this ice grain. The water ice is just barely is there, but it's organics are dominating the spectrum. And we see sometimes that's the mass range ends here at about 200 mass units, but we have an extended range where the mass resolution is terrible, but we see there's stuff there, sometimes up to 2,000, several thousand atomic mass units. So that's why we speak of macromolecules here, and what we see here is probably just fragments that formed from the impact, from much larger molecules. And we did a thorough two to three year campaign to analyze the different signatures here and mimic it with our analog experiment, and we concluded on this sentence that it's highly cross-linked macromolecular or polymerized material with oxygen and nitrogen-bearing functional groups with mostly isolated aromatic ring substructures which are connected by short aliphatic chains. I should leave out this slide. And just, yeah, it's just to be precise, I show it, but people like much more to show that I show an example what this would look like. So, isolated aromatic substructures, some fused ones, some PAH-like structures, because most of them are isolated, because we see this strong benzene peak connected by short aliphatic chains, so we don't see any aliphatic chains larger than C4. And we have we are sure about oxygen and strong indication for nitrogen functional groups. So this is from complex material, from abiotic processes, so it's not an indicator of any prebiotic chemistry, but of course it also is not in disagreement with prebiotic chemistry. Like this shows, this also fulfills the constraints of the organic material we found, and this is a biogenic molecule. And we also had to explain to the reviewers of the paper how do you produce these ice grains, why only in so few and why then so high concentrations. And we came up with this idea of an organic, hydrophobic organic film on top of the water table here. That's inside the crustal cracks again. And then we have our bubbles, and they form the blue guys. These are then the salt-rich grains, but they would also throw up almost pure organic droplets, and they will develop an ice crust, of course, when they go up through the vents embedded in this water vapor. And that's why only some of these grains have this property, but then they have high concentrations. And this idea is not totally crazy, because it also works on Earth. We found papers and talked to people later that work on cloud formation. It's a very broad topic there. You won't believe how many people work on cloud formation nowadays. I'm sure it's like 1,000 people in Germany, scientists work just on cloud formation, if not more. Just because it's so important for climate change. So there was a rich literature on that. And some also work on ice clouds. And these organic film drops that are thrown up by bursting bubbles from the organic microlayer we have everywhere floating on the ocean, they are super nucleation cores for ice grains. And of course here the bubbles don't come from the depths of the ocean, they are entrained by breaking of waves. But the principle of from a bursting bubble produce both salty droplets, which you actually smell when you go along the sea, that's just the aerosol, and organic film drops, that's the same thing. And the size here, it's very nicely matches the abundances and the sizes of the ice grains we find on Enceladus. So we now hypothesize that the organics not come from the ice crust or the ocean, but probably originate from the hydrothermal core. And you can, simulations indicate that you can transport the material from the core to the surface relatively easily. Because you have a thermal gradient. I mean, you have here like 100 degrees, you have 0 degrees here, that there's no, the system is relatively undisturbed. You just have to model the tidal forces, and then you have naturally the convection of material flowing up here, and then you have the ascending gas bubbles also. If you produce the gases here, of course they will exsorb slowly as pressure decreases, but the hydrogen certainly will be gases form here at 80 bar already. So also the bubbles, they can serve as a carrier of solid constituents, bringing the material up here to the water surface. And we think that these complex organics we found are just the tip of the organic icebergs, because that's the fraction of the organics that are in Enceladus that are so easily detectable, even with this detector, which wasn't even built for this task. So it shows a big, lots of organic peaks at high concentrations because of this specific generation mechanism. But we are now already analyzing the other ice grains where the organics are less concentrated. But we see there's a whole zoo of organics there, and some of them are dissolved in the ocean. And that's what we are working on now, and we have just recently published a paper on the organics which we think are dissolved in the ocean, and which agree with hydrothermal activity at the bottom. So it makes sense that Enceladus core is just an enormous organic factory. It's not just the detection of organics argues for it, but also the theory. If you think what the scenario is here. So rock in the outer solar system, if you form a rock in the outer solar system, it's chondritic. It's already very much enriched in organics. So some of these chondritic meteorites or cometary materials, probably also a good analog. You easily find a few percent, 10% of organics and complex organics. So you have a rich organic chemistry to start from. And then you have this hydrothermal circulation, which can easily mobilize it. That's the first thing. But of course, will process inevitably all the organics. If you cycle it through all this temperature and different pressures and different pHs, then you will change the organic chemistry. And of course, you have a huge catalytic rocky surface. It's like the rock to water ratio is 5:1. That's the 20%. Porosity. You can choose your catalytic rock of choice. I mean, and then promote organic chemistry there. And then you have this convective flows and pores and bubbles. All good. All positives for organic reactor. The question is, of course, and that's what we could not answer yet. Is this evolving towards a prebiotic chemistry, or are already fish swimming in the ocean? It's not off the table, but we need, of course, with the Cassini missions, the instruments were not optimized to do the task. So now we have to go there again. But the reason, of course, we know from Earth that hydrothermal sites at the bottom of the oceans are biotopes that developed independent from sunlight, and especially these alkaline hydrothermal vents, and we have alkaline systems very likely on Enceladus. There are few left on Earth now, but in early Earth they were pretty common, and many people think that work, there are experts on the field, think that life first evolved on these alkaline heterothermal systems. And this, of course, increases again the astrobiological potential of Enceladus. All right, so coming to the end, future Enceladus missions has the goal to probe for prebiotic chemistry, but it will probably take, this is now very future spacecraft, yeah, right. So the next one will probably not look like that, but of course the flight time, even if you're lucky, is 8 years, 7 to 8 years, and you have to assemble spacecraft, and so mission proposals are currently evaluated, so even the best case it will be 15 years. But the goal will be to look for at least to further evaluate if there's life or at least prebiotic chemistry. And now finally, because it's an astronomy colloquium, I will also want to show the astronomical perspective on things, because classically the habitable zone is defined by the possibility of liquid water on the surface. And of course here in the you are close to the sun. Water ice was not a common building material here inside the snow line. So ice is much more common in the outer planetary systems. And now in the past years we see that it's possible to melt this ice, so that it's a very common phenomenon that you have liquid water and much more liquid water in the outer solar system than in the inner solar system. Of course, the observation of these habitats is much more difficult than an Earth-like exoplanet, but still in principle, like cosmologically, I think these habitats are more numerous, or at least the candidates are more numerous than bodies with liquid water on the surface. And with that, I'm at the end, and hope you enjoyed and have some questions. Thanks.
That was truly wonderful, Frank. Thank you so much. I am sure there are many questions. I see the first one here already. So, please, Stefan.
Yeah, thank you very much for the interesting talk. You explained that the ice crust is thinner at the poles, but you didn't explain why it's thinner at the South Pole compared to the North Pole.
Yes.
What is the explanation?
Yeah, that's a good question, and people, there's not an easy answer to that. But it can be shown that if you, at one point, you make one ice shell a little bit thinner than the other one, then you have a runaway effect to make it even thinner. That's one point. The other point is, if you are thin enough to crack the ice shell, then you automatically focus everything on the South Pole. That has, there's a recent paper just coming out this week that explains for the first time in a satisfying way why you have these four parallel fractures. And as soon as you open up the crust, then you release all the pressure on the opposite side. So we'll never
first
make it thinner, you win, and then when you crack, you avoid any cracking on the other pole. So it's a runaway effect.
So can it crack more now that it has cracked? Because if you say it's a runaway effect that gets thinner, then I can imagine at some point the entire South Pole blows out. It's like the Death Star or something.
Sure. But of course you have also materialists falling back to the surface. So you have some deposition again, but of course net loss of material. So people have calculated that the moon, if it loses material at this rate, and it is 4.5 billion years old, then it lost 30% of its primordial mass. And you have signs of extinct tiger stripes. So there's, I have to go back. I can do it quicker here. I mean, this whole South Polar region is very young. There's no crater. This is old. There's craters, and you see all kind of tectonic activity. And people think that this is an extinct tiger stripe, and that actually the region is moving from there to there, and that this is also the least active of the tiger stripe. So people think that this tiger stripe will go out at some time, and new ones will develop over here.
So does it turn into an egg at some point because of all the material raining back?
Turn into a what?
An egg.
An egg?
Yes, because if it all leaks out on this side and sort of rains back onto the surface, you can...
No, the moon is correcting for that.
Okay. I mean, okay.
The moon always wants to have a... equipotential surface.
I have a more serious question. So we were having a discussion about the mass depletion time here, because okay, the discussion started when it was still just sort of a ring-like ocean and the porous core wasn't there, and then with mistakes undoubtedly we got a 3 gig a year mass depletion time to basically vent out the entire ocean. If you include the core, then it would be, I think, about 3 times more. It would be of the order 10 gig a years. Do you, like, that's inconveniently close to the age of the solar system, I would argue. So
yes,
so,
yes.
So is there a way of basically replenishing
okay,
this one way
argue,
or another?
Well, that explains why it has such a large rocky core, right? If you add 30% all water ice, then it would be much more in the range of the other icy moons. Mm-hmm. But there's another hypothesis that argues for that the moon is not primordial. That's one of the big debates in the Saturnian system, that these small icy moons that they formed from the ring system, the much later time, that the ring was much more massive earlier. It was almost certainly created from a moon that came to the Roche limit and was busted up. And if it was a big moon like Titan, then you have a very massive ring. And models show that the moon will create small, that the ring will create moons that migrate outward. And if you believe all that, then the orbital position of the moon argues for an age of about 200 million years only. But there's a big debate. Primordial, so it's either very young or very old.
Some jogging. An astronomical question for Io, that is seismically very active. The tidal dissipation is pumped by orbital interaction with its neighboring moons.
Yes.
Is there something similar going on for Enceladus, or
yes,
is it living yes on whatever disturbance there was initially?
Indeed, you need an orbital resonance to maintain the eccentricity, and here it's an orbital resonance with the moons that is two further out, Dione. And with
okay
that, the eccentricity is maintained. But on
okay
a lower level than with the Galilean moons. Mm.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ralph. This is appreciated.
This is great stuff. I'm as an astronomer, I'm stunned about all these details that you can get from these moon systems. I have a very technical question. How much material did the probe actually collect? I mean, how many dust grains, how many kilograms or grams, and why why are you still analyzing it? Shouldn't it be done, or how? I mean, the data are all long taken, right?
Yeah, so, okay. I try to give a short answer, which is difficult. So the instrument was not built to fly through such a plume, and it has a dead time of 1 second. So although it probably gets 100,000 hits per second, it can analyze only one spectrum per second at best. And in the plume traversal, takes a minute or so. So for each plume traversal, we only have some tens of detections. But our biggest treasure is the E-ring. So we spent integrated time of almost years in the E-ring. And there we have indeed almost 1 million individual ice grain spectra, and we are not done yet. We have employed a machine learning algorithm that picks out the most interesting ones for us now. Yeah, that's, yes. But I mean, it's really, even if you integrate it, it's not, I haven't done it, but it's not much, because it's submicron grains mostly.
Ah, okay. So my second question was, wouldn't you polluting then your detector, but if it's so few of these grains, that may not be a problem?
Yeah, I mean, normally in the E-ring it's not a problem, but with the plume traversals, that was a serious question. We did calculations, and because we really, of course, the water vapor, the water constituents, they will just go. And we have a decontamination heater for that. So also the organic constituents. So you can heat it up to 100 degrees. That's under zero pressure enough for almost every organic. But the salts, they don't. So we indeed see increase. So even if we have a salt poor grain, the salty signals from 2005 are much lower than the salty signals from 2015. So we build up a systematic background of salinity on our target, and we can observe that. Yeah.
So by staying so long in the E-ring, can you actually do some form of archaeology in that you could potentially trace the change of composition over time by measuring the composition in different places?
Very good question. Yeah, we do. We do. We can see
and?
It. We can see two things mainly. First, that only in the outer E-ring, that's when the particles get old. They over time they migrate outward. In the outer E-ring, we observe grains that are maybe some tens of years old. The modelers predict how old they are. And then you see that some become almost pure salt grains. So they're exposed to, sublimations are very efficient, but plasma sputtering is. So they are slowly eroded. The ice is eroded away, and the salinity increases if you go out. And the second thing is that also the organic chemistry changes a lot. So some hydrogen is kicked out of the organic compounds. So we see more unsaturated organics, and we also, but the complex organics, the chance of detection complex organic goes away, because they seem to be destroyed by UV or plasma.
Okay,
So there's
some secular evolution that happens after having left Enceladus.
Yes.
But you can distinguish between the part that is actually.
Yes. We know what happens in. But if the measurements if we're close to the moon, there the E-ring is the same as in the plume itself. We could make a comparison. Yeah.
I mean, this was just great. And I think that the contents of this in a popular form, it was almost it was practically popular, what you said. There should be a written version of this in German. Darf ich Sie an der SOW-Redaktion verpitzen? Oder machen Sie selbst den Vorschlag?
Ja, also, naja,
I ask whether I can tell the editors of Stein und Weltraum, German popular magazine.
I did write in 2015 and 16, I did write a long article in Spektrum der Wissenschaft and in Scientific American.
Okay.
Also.
So that's.
So the last part.
Done.
At that time, we didn't have a satisfactory explanation for the heating, and the complex organics were not published yet. But everything else is in the 2016 and 17 Scientific American articles. They are the latest.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So maybe you write down just the news. Two important, definite pieces of news. Okay, but then fine. If there is one such written, great.
Thanks. So, I've got a question about the model of conduction there. So you said there was a global and pretty stable convection going on with material from the poles to the equators and in through the core again.
Yeah.
Is that something you can observe on the ice shell, or is it too thick to be submerged like continental plates on Earth?
This just comes from the model. There's no observation really.
Okay.
I mean, the observation which is linked to this convection is the thin ice shell.
Yes.
Right.
Okay.
But I cannot see any other means how we can constrain this convection.
Okay. And on the poles, is there any direct the North Pole? Is there any direct observation of how
it's thin
it is?
It's really old, so
okay.
there was no tectonic activity.
Mm-hmm.
So it's from the topography you can conclude that it's depressed, that it's thin,
mm-hmm.
but it's really old.
Okay.
So that's really. And that was a long riddle, and now with the model that shows that once you open the cracks, all the tectonics happen in the south, whereas the North Pole is left in peace and is stable forever, then this explains it. But it's very different in terms of if you look at the surface south and north is totally different, couldn't be more different.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. Some more question?
Next to you.
You.
You said that there is the idea that maybe those ice moons are not primordial.
Yeah.
And through that we suspect that the E-rings are formed from the, I should say, leakage of the ice moons. Could you, through estimation of the size of the E-ring, somehow go back to see if it was originally bigger, or if it's round about the, what would it have been if it was just leakage?
Yeah, so the E-ring is only produced, or almost exclusively produced by the venting activity on Enceladus. And it is stable. It is, if you would switch Enceladus off, the E-ring would go away. So it's in an equilibrium state. To get it in an equilibrium state, you have to maintain it over some 100 years. So what points at the birth of these moons is the main rings. So the idea that the main rings, they now have the mass of about this small Mimas here, it's even a little smaller than Enceladus. But modelers say if you burst a Titan-like moon here at the Roche zone, you have supermassive rings, which will then spit out tiny moons here, and you can observe it. You observe the moon in the ring still forming tiny moons, like 10, 20 kilometers in diameter. And if you, and this, it is also, and they slowly migrate outwards, and that also works. If you have the massive rings, then you will produce objects that are as big as these guys here. And from the position of the moon, you can, from the speed of the outward migration, you can reverse calculate when this happened, and this is about 200 million years for Enceladus. For Tethys, it's a little bit further back. And, yeah, but the first moons come very quickly.
Any further questions? Okay, in the interest of time, I will declare this the final question.
Okay, our moon is 3,400 kilometers diameter, and this is 500 kilometers diameter. So factor of 7 less smaller. So, oh, I have a good comparison here. Europa almost precisely has the size of our moon, of Luna. But I exaggerated Enceladus here. I remember, yeah, it was too small. You couldn't see anything, so I make it a little bit bigger. But actually, it's 7 in diameter. That's the ratio.
How many times the volume?
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's much smaller. Yeah.
So I think we set a new record for duration of the discussion session this semester. So before we thank Frank again, so Frank is around until tomorrow morning very early. So we're going for the colloquium dinner this evening immediately after the colloquium. If you would like to join, talk to me or Ralph. The target place is going to be the Dorfschenke in here in Neuenheim. Let me now also announce a very special colloquium for next week. It's going to be the Christmas colloquium. And as a result, for those of you who got claustrophobic thinking of Enceladus, we're going to zoom in further to megaliths. And these are rocks that are even smaller. But they're pretty big if you think about them in a human context. And so Stefan Meder is going to talk about basically archaeoastronomy and how we can learn about the precession of the Earth's pole by looking at archaeological finds in Brittany. So I look forward to seeing you all there next week. And for now, let us please thank Frank again for a really amazing talk.